Stay cool.
This is a Thor News presentation. Hit the button, baby. Thor News presents...
Dragon's Lair, the fantasy adventure where you become a valiant knight on a quest to rescue the fair princess from the clutches of an evil dragon. In the mysterious caverns below the castle, your odyssey continues against the awesome forces that oppose your efforts to reach the Dragon's Lair. Lead on, adventurer. Your quest awaits.
December is half over and Christmas Day is fast approaching, so look for harried holiday shoppers to ramp up their spending this week to take advantage of a robust job market, the lowest gasoline prices in 5 years. And most of the data, well, they're mostly expected to be positive.
No one knows where to put it. It's coming out everywhere. It's coming out of the Permian. It's coming out of the Eagle Ford. There literally is no place to refine it, no place to put it. The boats, the big Suez Max carriers are all filled up, and I don't know where this stuff's going to go. There's some very large producers that are not able to cover with their cash flow to cover their drilling budgets. So push comes to shove, who knows which ones are going to go under. There will be some that go under. Yesterday we saw Halliburton, by the way, lay off 1,000 people. It was overseas, but Halliburton has been a principal driver of job growth in this country. So, you know, you've got job growth under question. You've got which of these firms has lent to the patch. It's just oil.
30 or 40 of them come in and they look hideous. But last year all my employees and our average age is 25.
Do you sense we're near a bottom? Or, you know, there are some who say by summertime we could see $40. What do you think?
A wild ride for crude oil by all accounts.
We're off 3.5% from the high, and yet the options market seem to be telling us that more is yet to come. I mean, it's not common. What often happens is, you know, it's a knee-jerk reaction. The market falls, and then people start buying insurance. Not this time. This time, they're out trying to get ahead of this because I think it feels a little bit different to a lot of people.
On Ugly Sweater Day,
when did Ugly Sweater Day become Ugly Sweater Day?
I don't know that. Research has it, I think, in the 1980s back in the UK is... A lot of people say that's where it started.
Apparently that is the biggest story CNBC. Apparently that is the biggest story CNBC could find when looking at this week. I believe that during these 25 days of media's Xmas to give America the very worst Christmas ever, we will see a correction in the markets before Christmas. Now I will confess to you that since quantitative easing forever quote-unquote stopped, my prediction has been wrong. I thought the markets would go down, and the markets kept going up until this week, where the markets suffered their worst loss in a single week since 2011. Now, my other half, the economy, I got right, interest rates. Now Krugman's saying they probably won't be raised in 2015, and I've been saying since 2008, 2009, when they lowered them to zero, that, and you can keep pumping the chest, but I don't think you'll get it to come back alive. So I think financial gravity is going to hold it to zero forever. Our new currency, whichever comes first. Now, we got some huge stories. I don't like to cover economy that much. It pisses most people off. So forgive me if I leave a lot in between the lines. First off, the biggest story by far is the fact that oil shit the bed. The most dependable, durable asset since we invaded Iraq in 2004. Rain or shine, it's been a black gold beast and dragon economy. Well, hey, guess what? The last 3 months, oil is down about 40%. Just cracked 60 a barrel, 50 a barrel. There's talk of 40 a barrel. What's kind of weird is OPEC's like, nah, we're totally cool with it. And Putin's still smiling, even though one of his main exports is dropping like Green Mountain Coffee and Abercrombie and Fitch. Oil's been dropping like it was Ed Hardy stock, man. Which makes me think two things. One, the currency war has become a commodities war, which is not good. Two, maybe the new energy is here. And, maybe the new energy is here and everybody knows it. It's only a matter of time. So if we find some better, I don't imagine it would take too long to switch over. It's more of a hopeful, optimistic, you know what I'm saying? Oh, another thing. Remember last year, Comet Ison, government shut down? Well, they went to pass a budget bill. Democrats, Republicans, senators, congressmen, And you know what happened? The Republicans jammed in some Ebola bacon. I'm pretty sure it's like been a whole shell game since Glass-Steagall was repealed, which allowed banks to bet with your savings and deposits. And so that basically, if the banks crash again, the Republicans allow them to get bailouts now, whereas supposedly it was forbidden before. So that's totally horrible. But like I said, man, bankers have owned us since 2008. It has been a dragon default, beast bailout, big blackmail economy. Bankers own everything in America now. Bankers run the show, you know? I mean, game over. Now it's a matter of convincing them not to depopulate, not to engage in World War III. Nobody wins. Might be too late. Skynet might have really come online in 1999. And they've been just building in final form since. Yeah, when I was growing up, I always had nightmares, real nightmares about nuclear war, societal collapse. And everybody was always worried about our government being infiltrated, us being taken apart from the inside. And hey, guess what, man? Seems like it's been 20 years since people remembered that. We were the one superpower. And then we just decided to start pissing on other countries, going to war for no good reasons, declaring war against rogue states. You know, we used to go to war against nations, not gangs who hide in mountains, man. Anyway, so it's all horrible news. And we've got the derivatives markets, which the Republicans pretty much put back in protections for banks who lose quadrillions on derivatives. Derivatives, credit default swaps, synthetic credit instruments, synthetic debt obligations. All crazy, kooky financial instruments that they took the monolith when it came down and they found it. And they decided to make financial instruments with it. Credit default swaps, derivatives. What it does, it leverages money. And they tranche it. Man, I don't even want to explain it all. You know, it's just such a, I'll just tell you it's bad. Warren Buffett declared derivatives weapons of mass destruction before he decided to make a few cold trillion off of them. So back to the derivatives. What you have is you have derivatives where, let's say you buy mortgage-backed security or bonds, bills. And what the derivatives do is say that, like, let's say if this $100,000 bond ever shits the bed and goes to pretty much zero, that the insurer will pay you 100 cents on the dollar for that lost investment. It's basically like you're investing money and then you're paying a premium to guarantee that you don't lose any money. It is one hell of a deal if you can get it, party people. So when I named my series Beast and the Dragon, remember the beast? The beast survives and only can eat. The beast has a very finicky diet. It can only survive on bailouts. And then the dragon is the default on some of these credit default swaps, derivatives, bonds, bills, corporate borrowing, is that they're all tranched and so amazingly interwoven, diabolically geniusly, that if one breaks, it's like dominoes. Dominoes with firecrackers. Made of dense metal under really heavy gravity. Okay, Shrapnel City, baby. Financial instrument, Shrapnel City, baby. So, you feeling me? You following me? So now, Venezuela is almost guaranteed to default. Their economy is mostly oil-based. Oil, as I mentioned before, somehow oil became a $3 bill nobody wanted. And so, Venezuela's in the tank, the peso's in the tank, even the ruble's in the tank. It looks like Venezuela's guaranteed to default. Now, I'd be on the lookout for brown swan defaults you didn't see before Venezuela hits the mat. I don't call them black swans because a black swan is technically something, a disastrous thing that you didn't foresee coming. So if you're talking about something as a black swan, it's not technically a black swan because you're talking about it, which means you see it. So we'll call this one a brown swan. So the brown swan is we might have some surprise defaulters soon because oil lost about $1 trillion in the last month, two or three. And so somebody lost $1 trillion. My guess it was a taxpayer. You know, that might not totally wash in till March, but my guess is we'll start feeling the pain right before Christmas. So whoever the weirdos are, they're craving doom. Well, here you go, man. Freak. And another bad news indicator for Thor News. Bill Gross of PIMCO, Pacific Investment Management Company, LLC. Is a global investment management firm headquartered in Newport Beach, California. Huge. First guy stepped down. It was like a two-man team. First guy stepped down. Gross is running it for a while. He's a legend, some on Wall Street. and unfortunately a hero to others, he kind of got forced out this month. And so, you know, there's like a tier right under Warren Buffett, and Bill Gross is in that tier. And the conspiracy theorist to me would say that him getting forced out is bullshit. Everybody wants to get out now. You know what I'm saying? But I thought Miss Childs made a great point. Was it him? Or was it a dollar depegged from gold post-80s credit boom market that did it, man? You know? It's not Jimi Hendrix. It's not J.K. Rowling.
For everything from loss prevention to cybersecurity, we're here to stand behind our commitments that we've made to our clients, our customers.
We're AIG.
We're here to help take on the risk.
For people, for companies, and the world.
To help you realize a better tomorrow.
Dungeons and Dragons, a dead end is a dead end.